Hello everyone. Hope you have watched Chapter 1 Python Fundamentals before you've reached here, if you're a beginner. But if you're already used to Python, then the order of chapter actually doesn't matter. But unlike other subjects, you can't skip chapters and do a particular chapter because you like that chapter or something like that. Because in computer science, every chapter is connected. So you understand the second chapter only if you've done the first. And you understand the third if you've done the first and the second. But like I said, this is for beginners. If you're watching this video because as a revision and you're already aware of Python rules, then jumping into any chapter actually doesn't matter. Is that clear? Okay. So in this chapter called data handling, we'll be talking about three topics here because this chapter, again, I will be dividing it into different parts. So in this part of the chapter, we will be talking about data types in Python. We will be talking about a very important term called mutable and immutable data types. And we'll be talking about operators. Operators word you have come across in the previous chapter also. There, I just mentioned the operators. I did not tell you what each of those operators do. Here, we are going to be learning each of those operators. Okay, so are you good to go? Yes, so let me just move to my next screen. The first topic is data types in Python. It's quite similar to what we did with literals, but basically what's a data type? Data type is the kind of data a particular language recognizes and all the operations associated with it. Oh, sounds too complicated? Okay, let me just simplify it. When I talk about 5 and 2, I can say they are integers. And can I do a 5 divided by 2? Yes, because the division operation is allowed with integers. Let's say I have hello and hi. Can I do a hello divide by hi? No, because they are strings and division operation is not allowed with strings. So that is what I meant by what are data types? The kind of data that can be recognized by a language or can be allowed by a language and the associated operations for each of these data types. Each of the data types that you will learn allow a specific set of operations which work on them. Okay, so that is why data types in Python is quite important. Now, data types are classified into four categories: the numeric data type, Boolean data type, sequence data type, and mapping. Okay. Under the numeric section, you have heard these three terms in the previous video also. Integer, what does integer mean? A number without a decimal point. Float, what does float mean? A number with a decimal point. Complex, I said, if you have learned complex numbers in maths, complex numbers have a real part as well as an imaginary part. If you look at the slide here, I've given an example of 3 plus 5j. So that's a complex number. The real part is 3 and the imaginary part is 5. So these are the three categories under the heading called numeric data type. What does the data type Boolean mean? Boolean can only be talking about two specific values, either the word true or false. Okay, so that is what Boolean means. And in Boolean data type, we don't call it Boolean. Specifically, what's the data type Boolean called in Python is called bool. Even integer is called int. Floating point numbers are called float. Then you have complex. So Boolean data types, if you talk about the type of the data, we will say it's of type bool. If you remember, we had learned a function called type in the previous chapter. So if I've written a is equal to true here, and if I write print type A, what does the type function do? Tells me the kind of data A is. So it will not tell me Boolean in that scenario. Though it's under the category of Boolean data types, it will tell me class bool. So be very specific about knowing those typical class names. Okay. Then we have sequence data types. In sequence data types, you have str, which stands for string, and we have learned anything that you write within single quotes or double quotes is going to be treated as a string. Then we have the list, and then we have the tuple. Now, all these chapters we are going to be learning, all these topics we are going to be learning as a chapter ahead. But let me just explain. So string, I told you, characters enclosed within single or double quotes. Now, what's a list? List is a collection of elements, homogeneous or heterogeneous. Oh, now what does this mean? Homogeneous and heterogeneous mean? sounds like some science terms. Okay, but what does homogeneous mean? If all the elements of the list are integers, or all are floating point, or all are strings, if they're the same kind, then we say they are homogeneous. Your example here is 1, 4, 6. So it means it is a homogeneous list. Heterogeneous list would mean I have 1, comma, Sita, comma, 25.6. So it could be talking about the roll number, the name, or whatever. So they are of different kinds. So list and tuples both can be homogeneous or heterogeneous. Now the only difference here in terms of the way they look, in terms of something else, I will talk about it later. In terms of the way they look, list is written within square braces or brackets, whereas tuple is written within parentheses. The round brackets are called parentheses. And the last category, you don't have to get worried about, what is ma'am saying and do we understand all this? Remember, the string, list, tuple, dictionary, what you see next, we are all going to be learning it as individual chapters. So we will go into details and learn about it. Then the last category is the mapping category. In the mapping category, we have a data type called dict. We call it the dictionary. Now, dictionaries are enclosed within curly braces. So list had square, tuple had parentheses or round brackets, and your dictionary has curly braces. Now, if you look at the dictionary here, it says 1:Pooja, 2:Raj. The element that you write before the colon is called the key, and what you write after the colon is called the value. So if you ever want to refer to Pooja, you will be referring to the key of Pooja, which happens to be 1. Okay, key and value confused? Don't worry. We will soon be learning all this as a chapter. So when we do it in details, things will be clear. But I couldn't be just talking about the basic data types, because when they ask you to write notes on data types in Python, you will have to mention all of them here. Clear? Okay, let's just move ahead. Then you need to know a very important question: difference between immutable and mutable objects or data. Now, what does immutable mean and what does mutable mean? Can you see some data types I've written under immutable, like int, float, complex, str, tuple, boolean? I've left out that. They're all under immutable. Whereas list and dictionary, they are under mutable. So what does that mean? Before I actually show you the diagrammatic representation, let me just tell you in terms of a definition. Okay, if you can change the value of that object in that memory location, then it is mutable. But if you cannot change the value of the object at a particular memory location, then it's called immutable. Okay, must have gone above your head. No problem. Look at the example. It's going to be explaining it very clearly. Okay, so let's say I have said A is equal to 10. What have we learned? Somewhere in memory, there is 10. It has a address or a memory location associated with it. In this example, I've shown it as 1, 2, 3, 10, 2, 3, 4. And I have A referring to 10. Okay, but the minute I write A is equal to 20, then what happens? Does this 10 get cancelled and become 20? No, we have learned. What happens is another memory block has value 20. And A, which was previously referring to 10, is now shifted its reference point and it's referring to 20, which probably, let's say, is at address location or memory location 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I did change the value of A from 10 to 20. But did I change the value at that particular memory location? Did you erase 10 and make it 20? No. Why? Because integers are immutable. You cannot go and change the value of 10 to 20. You can make A shift to many values, but at a particular memory location, you can't erase it and write the new value. That is what I mean by immutable. Okay. I'm showing you another example with respect to strings. Okay, I have S is equal to Rita. So somewhere in memory, Rita is stored, and that memory location, let's say, is 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And who's referring to that memory location? A variable named as S. Then I realized, oh, it was not Rita, it was Nita. So what can I do? So I think I can do something like this. Okay, now this I want to tell you. In sequence data types, that is strings, tuples, and list, each of those elements have a number or an index associated with them. The first element we say is at location 0, the second element is at location 1, and so on. So what do I mean by S of 0? The first character of the string that is stored in S. And what is the first character here? R. I want to replace that with N. So I wrote S of 0 is equal to N. So it looks like the R will get cancelled off and N should appear there. But it doesn't have to appear. And this statement that you have written here, let me tell you children, it is not a valid statement. Because this looks like I am trying to change Rita to Nita at that memory location. So this is not allowed in Python, this particular statement, because strings are immutable. So what if I wanted to write Nita then? So then if I write the statement as this, S is equal to Nita, then what happens is in some memory location, Nita will be stored and S will be pointing to Nita. So it's not pointing to Rita anymore and it comes and points to Nita. Is that clear? So you have not changed the value at a particular memory location. So if you cannot change the value of an element at the same memory location, then you say it's immutable. But if you can change the value, like list and dictionary, then it's going to be mutable. I'm just showing you a list here. I have a list, and I told you lists are written in square brackets. So I have a list 10, 20, 30, 40. So diagrammatically, I just drew a list with all these elements. And let's say this list is in memory location 2, 3, 2, 3, 4. Okay, and who's referring to it? A variable named as L. Now, I don't want 10 in the first location. I want it as 50. I just told you list, strings, they're all sequence data types. And sequence data types follow a numbering, first element being at 0. So if I write this line, L of 0 is equal to 50, here will it allow me? Yes. What will it do? It will go to the L of 0 location, which is the location of 10, and change it to 50, like you see in the diagram. But look at, note the memory location of both your diagrams. 2, 3, 2, 3, 4 in the beginning, 2, 3, 2, 3, 4 here as well, which means, did you change the value at a particular memory location? Yes. And why could you do it? Is because list is mutable, allows the changes at a particular memory location. Is that clear? So an important question, that is difference between immutable and mutable objects or data elements. Okay. Next, we'll come to operators. We have seen operators in the previous chapter. I listed all the operators. Let's look at each of those operators in details. The first one that I'm going to start with is arithmetic operators. You'll have all used arithmetic operators in class, in any class. In fact, even now you must be using arithmetic operators. Okay, so the arithmetic operators are classified into two categories, unary operator and binary operator. What does the word unary mean? Unary means that this operator will only require a single operand, whereas binary means this operator requires two operands. Let me just give you an example. Can I ever write 5 multiplied by and not write anything after it? Does that make sense? No. Why? Because the multiplication symbol or the multiplication operator is a binary operator. It requires two operands, one before it and one after it. Whereas, can I write minus 5? A is equal to minus 5? Yes. Here, minus is not taken as subtraction, but the unary minus operator, because it requires only one operand. Okay, so you have unary operators and binary operators. I'm not going to be explaining to you what plus and minus and multiplication means because you already know it. I'm going to only talk about division, which is the true division, the single hash, slash, two slashes, making it floor division. The percentage symbol that you see there is called the modulus operator. And the two asterisk sign that you see there is called the exponential operator. Okay, so I'll start with the exponent operator because the division, the floor division and the modulus operators are all related. So I'll talk about it a little later. When I write 10**3, what does it mean? 10^3. Okay, so if you have to write a raise to, you can't type raise to in your programming, I mean in your IDE. Then suppose I want to have a raise to value to be calculated, what can I do? One way is using the exponential operator, which is 10**3, which means 10^3, which is nothing but 1000. Now let me explain the division, the floor division and the modulus operators. You almost have already seen three images down, okay? Division operation, I don't need to tell you in details, like what you have learned in your lower classes. When you divide a number by another number, what is the answer that you get? Now, if I write 11 divided by 4, if I get O, my annotations there of the previous one is just showing you a cross sign. So let me just clear that. So there's nothing wrong there. It was just the annotation of the previous screen. Okay, so if I do 11 divided by 4, even if you do 11 divided by 4, you would have got your answer as 2.75. Correct? I've just shown you the working there, but otherwise also you would know what it means. So you got 11 divided by 4 as 2.75. That's called true division. The division that is represented by a single slash. What does 2/ mean? 2/ means floor division. Now, what does the word floor mean? Let me explain that to you. Okay. Floor is a very common term used in a lot of languages. Okay. Suppose they say, find the floor of, let's say, 3.5. What does floor of anything mean? Floor of 3.5 will give you the closest integer which is smaller than or equal to 3.5. Now, what do I mean by that? Suppose I have to draw 3.5 on a number line. Okay, so let's say this is my number line. Okay. This is 0, this is 1, this is 2, this is 3, this is 4, correct? And let's say if it's negative, then you would have -1, -2, -3, -4. Now, what did I tell you? Floor of any number, we were talking about floor of 3.5, will give you an integer or a number that is closest to 3.5, but less than or equal to it, but an integer, okay? So if you look at 3.5, 3.5 is between 3 and 4, okay? But is 4 smaller than 3.5? No, the number has to be closest to 3.5 and smaller, less than or equal to. So the closest number to 3.5, which is less than or equal to 3.5. So it can't be equal to, I want an integer. So 3.5 can't be equal to 3.5. So what answer do I get? I get the answer as 3. So floor of 3.5 is giving you what? 3. Okay. What if I wanted floor of, let's say I have a number called 2.9. So do you agree it's between 2 and 3? Now, what is the closest integer which is less than 2.9 is nothing but 2. Correct? Now, so here it's very easy. Suppose you have 12.5, just remove 0.5, it's 12. Suppose it's 11.999, just remove 0.999, it is 11. If it's positive, it's very easy. I could just say truncate all the decimal parts and you get that number as it is. But what happens when it is a negative? Suppose I have -3.5, okay? And I want to find the floor of -3.5. Now you need to know, is -3 smaller than -3.5 or -4? -4. So floor of -3.5 would give me -4. So floor of 3.5 gave me 3, but floor of -3.5 will give me -4. So I hope floor concept is clear. If floor concept is clear, floor division is very easy. Okay, it's 11 floor division 4. So what you do is you do it as a regular division. Okay, and regular division, what did I get my answer as? 2.75. Find the floor of it. Floor of it, 2.75. What are the two integers before and after 2.75? One is 2 and one is 3. But I want the one which is less. So what is the answer going to be? 2. So floor division of 11 and 4 will give me answer to. So you don't have to actually perform this calculation, okay? You don't have to actually perform this calculation. Is what you have to do is do a regular division. Look at the answer that you get. That's called your quotient. Look at the quotient that you get. If the quotient is a number with decimal places, if it was just two, even floor division would give you two, okay? But if the quotient is a number with some decimal places, you just floor that quotient. When you floor the quotient, you get the answer of floor division. Clear? Okay, now what does modulus operator do? Modulus operator gives me the remainder. Now you might think, when I did 11 divided by 4, I am getting remainder 0. But modulus operator doesn't take true division as its division concept, but instead it takes the floor division. So what was floor division of 11 and 4 giving me quotient as 2? So what does the modulus operator do? 4 twos are 8, remainder is 3. So the modulus operator gives you answer 3. So remember, the modulus operator doesn't take into consideration the quotient that you get from the division operation, whereas it takes into consideration the quotient that you get because of the floor division operation. I hope it's clear. The next two slides here, these were all positive numbers. 11 was positive, 4 was positive. Okay. In the next two slides, I will be talking about what if the numbers were negative, then what happens? But this concept of flooring should be clear now. What does floor of a number mean? Is that clear? Okay. So let's just go to my next screen. But before that, let me clear all the annotations. Otherwise, all these characters will appear on my next screen. Okay, so I've put up three questions. Okay, let's do one at a time. You must be wondering, why has ma'am left so much of space below? Is because I actually want to solve. Okay, mathematically, if A is minus 7 and B is 2, what would A divide by 2 give me? What is A divide by 2 going to give me? So the division sign is going to give me what? Nothing but 3.5. Do you agree with me? It's going to give me 3.5. A regular maths, I'm not saying anything, but definitely minus 3.5 because one of them has a negative symbol. So which means my quotient of a division operation is also going to give me minus 3.5. Okay, then I told you, what would floor division give me? Now think, I want floor of minus 3.5. Floor of minus 3.5, is it minus 4 or is it minus 3? We just had learned some time back, it's going to be minus 4. So floor division gives me the answer as minus 4, correct? Because floor of minus 3.5 is nothing but minus 4. Now modulus, okay, for modulus, I'm going to actually work it out. Please excuse the way I'm drawing because I'm actually using the mouse, okay? I have 7 and I have 2. So 7 is the dividend, and 2 is the divisor. Okay. And I said for modulus, we'll always be taking what? What we got as the floor division. So what did I get the floor division as? Minus 4. Okay. So 2 into, let me not overdraw it, otherwise it'll look crazy. 2 into minus 4. 2 into minus 4 is nothing but minus 8. Okay. And then what is it basically? It's a subtraction of minus 7 minus of minus 8, correct? Normal maths. So it's minus 7 plus 8. Minus 7 plus 8 gives me what as the remainder? Will it give me a minus 1 or 1? Minus 7 plus 8 gives me nothing but 1 as the remainder. So that's the answer for the first part of the question. That is, the division would give you minus 3.5, the floor division would give you minus 4, and the modulus operator would give you 1. Now let's look at the next part of it. The next part of it talks about A being positive, but B is negative. Again, obviously, division operation is going to give me what? It's 7 divided by minus 2. It's going to give me what? Nothing but minus 3.5. Again, what is floor division going to give you? Floor of minus 3.5 is nothing but minus 4. Now let's see what is the modulus operator going to give you. So I'm going to perform the operation once again, but now the dividend is positive and the divisor is negative. And what did I say? We will always be taking the quotient that we got with the floor division. So what did I get the quotient as the floor division as? Minus 4. Okay. Minus 2 into minus 4 is going to be just 8. Correct? And 7 minus 8 is going to give me nothing but minus 1. So this is what your modulus operator gives you. Clear? Okay. Let's look at the next one. Division again, I know minus 7 divided by minus 2 is going to give me just positive 3.5, correct? So what will now floor division give me? Floor of 3.5 is nothing but 3, correct? Because now it's the positive side. Okay, and what would the division actually give me? Okay, so you have minus 7 here, you have minus 2 here, and I have to take the quotient that I got from the floor division, which is nothing but 3. Okay, so minus 2 into 3 is nothing but minus 6. Correct? Okay, so what am I doing? It's basically minus 7 plus 6. Minus 7 plus 6 is nothing but minus 1. So this would be your answer for the percentage or the modulus. We should not call it percentage anymore. It's the modulus operator. Is that clear? So if you know the floor concept, then you can perform division. But remember, when you want to get the answer of the modulus operator, what should I be doing? I should be not taking the real division's quotient, but I should be taking the floor division's quotient. Is that clear? Okay, fine. Now, these were numbers which were positive or negative, dividend and divisor, okay, or both negative. But what if they have decimal places? Like, what if it was not minus 7 and it was minus 7.5? Then what happens? Okay, so let me just clear all these before I go to my next screen. And let's go ahead. Okay, now we have both decimals. So let's see what happens. Okay. Regular maths of your division operation would tell me that division, please work out children, division of 9.5 divided by minus 2.5 is going to give me 3.8. Okay, so the division is going to give me 3.8. I'm not teaching you division here. You are already aware of division, right? So division operation gives me minus 3.8. What would floor division do? Floor division gives me the floor of minus 3.8, which is nothing but minus 4. Okay, then what would the modulus operator do? Okay, so let me just work it out for you. So you have 9.5, okay, and you have minus 2.5. The divisor is one with a negative sign, no problem. And I have to take which quotient I said? The quotient that I get with the floor division, which is minus 4. Okay, so 2.5 multiplied by 4 is 10. But you have two minus signs there. So minus 2.5 multiplied by minus 4 is positive 10. And when I say 9.5 minus 10, I'm going to get nothing but minus 0.5. Okay, so this is the result of my modulus operator. And here also I would like to tell you children, you would get it as minus 4.0. Reason being, in the previous one, both the numerator and the denominator, that's your dividend and your divisors, were integers. Okay, so modulus operator gives you answer only as an integer. Floor division would give you an integer answer. But here, since they are floating point numbers, I'm going to get a floating point answer. I will talk about it a little later in the next session. Okay, so now let's come to the next session. Again, I don't have to worry about division. Division is going to give me minus 3.8. Floor division again is going to give me minus 4 or minus 4.8. To be more precise, minus 4.0. Then what do I do with the actual division? Okay, now the minus sign is inside. So it's minus 9.5. And I'm dividing it by 2.5. Okay, and which quotient should I take? We said the floor division quotient, which is minus 4. Okay, 4 into 2.5 is 10, we said, but there's a negative sign, so it's minus 10. Correct? Then minus 9.5 minus of minus 10, which is minus 9.5 plus 10. Minus 9.5 plus 10 gives me a positive 0.5. Clear? Okay, I think you guys are understanding now. Okay, and you'll be able to do, see, these are very small things, but they could ask you output questions and, you know, catch you there. So you're like, okay, what is the right answer? If you know the right method, you don't have to worry about what is the right answer. You will get the right answer. Clear? Okay, so now let me talk about this again. Again, here I am going to get division as, sorry, division. I will not get, let me just erase that. You will not get a minus 3.8. You will just get a 3.8 because both are negative. The negative signs will cancel out, right? So what will floor division give me answer as 3? Okay, so let me just do the division, but so it's minus 9.5 divided by minus 2.5. Okay, I have to take the quotient of the floor division, so which is 3. So 3 into 2.5, minus 2.5 is nothing but minus 7.5. Okay, and I have to subtract here. So minus 9.5 plus 7.5 is nothing but minus 2.0. Is that clear? So I hope the division, the floor division, and the modulus operator is clear. Now let them ask you numbers with decimal point, without decimal point. I think you should be able to easily handle it. Is that clear? Okay, so just let me just clear my annotations there.